Good evening and welcome to the Westminster College Diversity Symposium, first event of this academic year. And what an event it is. Those of us who have worked on making this opportunity possible are excited that Scott Momaday has returned to Westminster. At least for those of you who got a program, Westminster College depends on diversity to make things happen. Check out the diversity of sponsors for this event, including the ushers who are first-year members of the Westminster College swim team. In addition to that list of groups who are sponsoring this event, there is a long list of individuals who have made this possible. I know that all of you are here. Thank you very much. Yeah, let's give a hand to all those people. Our speaker, Scott Momaday, is currently Regents Professor of Humanities at the University of Arizona. His book, House Made of Dawn, has been referenced as a piece of Navajo silverware. It is for this work of literature that he received the Pulitzer Prize for Fiction in 1969. However, Dr. Momaday's work is a set of silverware, each piece sparkling with his graceful writing. A member of the Kiowa Nation, he was born in Oklahoma and grew up in the Southwest. He grew up in the rich environment of storytellers, teachers, writers, and artists, namely his parents. He grew up in two worlds that have made for a richness of life, and this evening he's going to share some of that with us. Scott Momaday is founder and director of the Buffalo Trust. This is a nonprofit foundation dedicated to the preservation of the sacred in Native American culture, and then to the transmission of this to the Native American children. This trust enables Native American children to know who they are in terms of their cultural inheritance, and then confident in that identity to claim their place in the world. Those of you who have read Dr. Momaday's work know of his acquaintance with the bear. It is for his poem entitled The Bear that Dr. Momaday was awarded the Academy of American Poets Prize. His play, Children of the Sun, was a commissioned work that was produced by Kennedy Center in 1997. Scott Momaday is a novelist, a playwright, a poet, a teacher, a painter, a storyteller. His PhD is from Stanford. He has held faculty positions at Stanford, at the University of California at Santa Barbara, at Berkeley, at Columbia, at Princeton, at the University of Moscow, and now at the University of Arizona. He's a longtime consultant of the National Endowment for the Humanities and for the Arts. Dr. Momaday has been recognized with numerous awards, including the Guggenheim Fellowship, Italy's highest literary award, a fellow of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences, and with the Gold Plate Award from the American Academy of Achievement. Be it a dialogue, a novel, a poem, a passage, when you read Dr. Momaday, you are reading a great American writer. He is also a narrator and a storyteller, and it is our pleasure to have him as the Diversity Symposium Fall Speaker for 2002, Dr. Momaday.
introduction.
Great.
Wonderful, very generous. You know, I was going to begin this in one way, and I changed my mind. I'm going to begin it in another, because I heard that the ushers were members of the swim team. And I was a swimmer at one time. About 22 years ago, I went to Arizona to start teaching at the university in Tucson. And as you may know, Tucson is abominably hot in the summer. And when I went there, I wasn't used to this heat. And so I had to find a way to deal with it. I very quickly found out that people in Tucson survive because they swim and they have two kinds of air conditioning. So I bought a house with two kinds of air conditioning and a large pool. And I decided that swimming would be my principal form of exercise. I started swimming laps. And I don't know if you know this, but swimming is one of the most boring occupations that man has devised. It is more boring than jogging. The scene doesn't change. And what you do is you swim laps and you look down at a black line at the bottom of the pool. Well, after a time I had to find some way to combat this deadly boredom. I had won my battle with the heat, but now there was this boredom. So I devised the idea, activity of composing epitaphs as I swam. And I have a little collection of these things. I have, you know, 2-lap epitaphs, 4-lap epitaphs. So I thought I would share a couple of these with you. They are, it's like eating peanuts. Once you get started with these things, you can't stop. So let me share with you a 2-lap that's called the Minor Writer. It goes like this. Certainly it was suicide. He read himself until he died. Well, that's the flavor of these things. I have another one that is a 4-lapper called On Chastity. Here lies a lady sweet and chaste. Here lies the matter. Chaste makes waste. You see how they go. Several years ago, I was asked to give a talk, a keynote address to a convention of ceramicists at Tempe, Arizona State. And I went there, and there were hundreds of ceramicists from all over the world. And I had no idea that there were so many, or that they were so well organized. They all wore little pottery name tags. Well, I gave the speech, but when I got home, I jumped in the pool, and I composed an epitaph. It goes like this. Here lies the potter, Tim Momaday, who has himself become his clay, and lest his memory be forgot, recycle him into a pot. Okay. All right, enough of that. I want to talk to you about story. Tell some stories and talk to you about storytelling, what I think it is and how it works in some measure. I'd like to tell you stories and talk to you about stories and to share with you my interest in the efficacy and healing nature of words and stories. And I would like first to tell you who I am. I am Scott Momaday, the one who has been so generously introduced to you on this occasion. But I am also Tsowai Tali. That is my Indian name, my Kiowa name. It means rock tree boy. And I'll tell you a little about that in a moment. But let me say first that the Kiowas are plains people. They reside in southwestern Oklahoma, where they have been for some time. Theirs is the last culture to evolve in North America, plains culture. They are late comers to the plains. Some hundreds of years ago, they were in the mountains near the headwaters of the Yellowstone River in what is now western Montana. And there is the earliest evidence we have of them. They began a legendary migration. They came down from the mountains and entered upon the Great Plains. They encountered the Crow people. The Crows welcomed them and taught them how to live on the open land, on that great expanse of grasslands that is in the middle of the continent. The Crows gave them the sun dance, and the Kiowas became a children of the sun. They journeyed southward after the solstices, down the rain shadow of the Rockies, into the southern plains. Their migration ended in what is now Oklahoma, where they arrived about the time of the Revolutionary War. And in alliance with the Comanches, an older tribe on the southern plains, they ruled the southern plains for 100 years. It was a golden age. With the acquisition of the horse, their plains culture, which is sometimes called the horse culture, sometimes called the centaur culture, their way of life reached its peak. Their warrior ideal, based upon the principles of bravery, fortitude, generosity, and virtue, that is, right behavior, appropriate behavior, was realized completely in that southern plains landscape, which is very beautiful. It's treeless, much of it. There are green belts running through it. There are rivers and grasses, rolling grasses. It's quite beautiful. And I often think with wonder, I often wonder how it was that they could come down out of the mountains and enter upon the Great Plains. You know, that required an adjustment that is almost inconceivable. It took what I think of as a great act of the imagination, but they did. I'm getting ahead of myself. In the course of their migration, the Kiowas lived for a time in the Black Hills of South Dakota and Wyoming. Devil's Tower, Wyoming, some of you have been there, I'm sure others have seen photographs of it, have seen Close Encounters of the Third Kind, in which that rock, that great monolith is prominent. It is where, as you recall, the extraterrestrials came down to meet with us Earthlings. It is a wonderful feature in the landscape. Well, the Kiowas named that place Tsowai. Tsowai meaning rock tree. And they had a story about it. I want to tell you that story. This is what the storyteller said. Oh, yes, we know about that. We know about that. This is how it was. There were 8 children playing in the woods. 8 Kiowa children, 7 sisters, and their brother. The boy was pretending to be a bear, and he was chasing his sisters through the woods. The little girls were pretending to be afraid of running. Well, in the course of this game, a terrible thing happened. The boy actually turned into a bear. And when the girls saw this, they were truly terrified, and they ran for their lives, bear after them. And as they were running, they passed a stump of a tree, a huge tree stump. And the tree spoke to them and said, if you will climb upon me, I will save you. So the sisters climbed on top of the tree stump, and as they did so, it began to rise into the air. The bear came to kill them, but they were beyond its reach. The bear reared up and scored the bark all around with its claws. And if you have seen Devil's Tower, you understand that it is like nothing so much in conformation as the stump of a tree, deeply grooved as with the claws of a great beast. The wonderful thing about it is that it is its size. Well, departing a bit from the story, the seven sisters were born into the sky, and they became the stars of the Big Dipper. That's the story. That's the story. Devil's Tower, Tsoa, rises 1,000 feet from base to summit. It's a mile around at the base. It rises 1,200 feet above the Belfouche River, which runs in the valley of its base. It has to be seen to be believed. It is one of the great awesome figures in the landscape. Well, when I was an infant, when I was less than 6 months old, I think, I was living with my parents and my grandmother in Oklahoma at the ancestral homestead there. And when my parents and I had gone to Devil's Tower, I don't remember it, I was too young, though I have been there many times since. They brought me back to Oklahoma, and we were all out in the arbor, which is a building that is very common in Oklahoma. It's a summer house near the winter house, and it's open on all sides. My grandmother's arbor was quite wonderful. It was a square frame building, screened all around so that the breezes could pass through from any direction. It was comfortable, even in the summer. So we were all there, and I was in a kind of hammock, I'm told. And an old man in the tribe, an old man whose name was Pol Ho, which means prairie wolf, came to visit. And he came into the arbor. Many of my relatives that were there, my grandmother and some aunts and uncles and cousins, my parents, they were all talking. You know, it was a busy, congenial time. And this old man came into the arbor, and when he did, all the other voices fell away. He was very wise. He was an arrow maker, a storyteller, and greatly honored and respected in the tribe. And he came and took me in his hands, and he held me, and he began to talk. And he talked for a long time, and as I say, all of the other voices were silent. His went on for a time. He talked about the Kiowas, all of the good and bad things that had happened to him in time. And when he was finished, he looked down at me and he said, "And now you are Tsoa-Tahi." And he gave me that name, Rock Tree Boy, to commemorate my having been taken to the sacred place in Kiowa tradition. And that name, names in general in the Indian world are very important. So I have a special regard for Tsoa, the rock tree, and I identify with the story. I am the reincarnation of the boy who turned into a bear. So I have bear power, and I struggle with that power from time to time. The bear and I enter into great struggles. And it's a good thing and a bad thing, but a thing. And I live with that, and I do, on occasion, turn into a bear. I don't mean to frighten you. I don't think it will happen to me. But I have sisters in the night sky. And I think about that story because it seems to me, what a story ought to be. It is a wonderful act of the imagination. Not only does it account for this strange feature in the landscape, but in the process, it relates the Kiowas to the stars. You can't ask much more of a story than that, I think. And so I tell you that to begin with as a way of telling you who I am. By means of such stories, the world is changed. This is the efficacy of language, when language is informed with imagination. The story is told, and in the telling, the world is created. Story enables us to be, to exist, to have being, and it enables us to be well. There is a healing aspect to storytelling. Well-being is the object of story. In words, I am made whole. In words is my world perceived as a totality, as in the story of Tsoa, words comprehend the earth and sky, the constellations, the universe. There is a prayer in Navajo which brings these things together. The power of words, the beauty of words, the landscape, the healing aspect of words. It's a prayer from the night chant. It goes like this. Seyige is Navajo, which means place among the rocks, place of origin. House made of dawn, house made of evening light, house made of dark cloud, house made of male rain, house made of dark mist, house made of female rain, house made of pollen, house made of grasshoppers. Dark cloud is at the door, the trail out of it is dark cloud. The zigzag lightning stands high upon it, male deity. Your offering I make, I have prepared a smoke for you. Restore my feet for me, restore my legs for me, restore my body for me, restore my mind for me, restore my voice for me. This very day, take out your spell. Your spell removed from me. You have taken it away from me. Far off it has gone. Happily I recover. Happily my interior becomes cool. Happily I go forth, my interior feeling cool. May I walk, no longer sore, may I walk. Impervious to pain, may I walk. With lively feelings, may I walk. As it used to be long ago, may I walk. Happily, may I walk. Happily with abundant dark clouds, may I walk. Happily with abundant showers, may I walk. Happily with abundant plants, may I walk. Happily on a trail of pollen, may I walk. Happily, may I walk. Being as it used to be long ago, may it be beautiful before me. May it be beautiful behind me. May it be beautiful below me. May it be beautiful above me. May it be beautiful all around me. In beauty, it is finished. The oldest stories are creation stories, and they are prayerful. Do not doubt that the first of all stories is prayer. We imagine the place of origin, and this prayer that I have just recited is what the prayer maker says. My friend Vine Deloria tells of a man who lived on a remote part of the reservation. He had no work and many mouths to feed. Moreover, his wife was expecting another child. One day a friend came to call on the family and said to the man, I see that you have come upon hard times. There is little food in your larder. But I know you to be a hunter. Why don't you kill a deer so that you and your family might have fresh meat? But the man replied, No. You see, it is inappropriate that I should take life just now, when I am expecting the gift of life. This idea of the appropriate is a definition of healing, I believe, which involves the sacred, that which is earned by sacrifice. Story is, in its first application, an articulation of the sacred. In the presence of the sacred, we are made whole. All the aspects of our being are restored for us. The experience is realized in belief and wonder, and in the imagination of that which is appropriate. In beauty, it is finished. On an afternoon in Oklahoma, I am talking to a 100-year-old woman. This is what the old woman says. The Kiowas came into the world through a hollow log. In my mind's eye, I have seen them emerge one by one from the mouth of that log. One night, a strange thing happened. I had written the greater part of the way to Rainy Mountain, all of it, in fact, except the epilogue. I had set down the old Kiowa tales. I had composed both the historical and autobiographical commentaries for the book. I had composed the two poems in which that book is framed. I had written the last word, as it were, and yet something was missing. Something was missing, and I began again to write. The manuscript lay before me in the bright light, small to be sure, but complete, or nearly so. I began again to write. This is what I wrote. On the first hours after midnight, on November 13, 1833, it seemed that the world was coming to an end. Suddenly the stillness of the night was broken. There were brilliant flashes of light in the sky, light of such intensity that people were awakened by it. With the speed and density of a driving rain, stars were falling. One of them was brighter than Venus. One of them was said to be as large as the full moon passing the earth. That event, the falling of the stars, that explosion of Leonid meteors which happened in 1833, is among the earliest entries in the Kiowa calendars. So deeply impressed upon the Kiowas is that old phenomenon that it is remembered still, it has become a part of the blood memory. I was thinking about all of this and thinking about the old woman Kosan who told me wonderful stories. And as I was looking down at the words on the page, something happened, something wonderful. The old woman Kosan, 100 years old, stepped out of the language and stood before me on the page. I was amazed, of course. And yet, it seemed to me that this was entirely appropriate. She said to me, "Yes, grandson, what is it? What do you want?" Oh, I replied, stammering. I was just now writing about you. I thought that you were, that you had, No, she said, and she cackled. "You have imagined me well, grandson, and so I am. You have imagined that I dream, and so I do. I have seen the falling stars." Well, grandmother, yes, yes. All of this imagining, I protested, this has taken place in my mind, hasn't it? You are not really here. You're not here in this room. It occurred to me that I was being very rude. But she seemed to understand. Be careful of your pronouncements, grandson, she said. You imagine that I am here in this room, do you not? That is worth something. You see, grandson, I have existence. I have whole being in your imagination. Oh, it is but one kind of being, to be sure, but it is perhaps the best of all kinds. If I am not here in this room, grandson, then surely neither are you.
I think I see what you mean.
Felt justly rebuked. Tell me, grandmother, how old are you?
Oh, I do not know, she replied. You know, sometimes I think that I'm the oldest woman on earth. You know, grandson, the Kiowas came to the world through a hollow log. In my mind's eye, I have seen them emerge one by one from the mouth of that log. I have seen them so clearly, how they were dressed, how delighted they were to see the world around. I must have been there. And I must have taken part in that old migration of the Kiowas from the Yellowstone to the southern plains, for I have seen antelope bounding in the tall grass near the Bighorn River. I've seen the ghost forests of the Black Hills. Once, I saw the red cliffs of Palomero Canyon. I was with those who were camped in the Wichita Mountains when the stars fell. You are indeed very old, I said, and you have seen many things. Yes, I imagine that I have, she said. And then she turned slowly around, nodded once, and receded into the language I had made. And I imagined that I was in the room alone. Well, that's a story, and it is based upon something that really did happen. Not too long ago, my grandmother had died. I was writing the way to Rainy Mountain. I had retraced the migration route of the Kiowas. The pilgrimage ended at Rainy Mountain Cemetery, where my Kiowa ancestors are buried. And I invited Kosan, the old woman, 100-year-old woman of this story, invited her, my father and I, invited her to come to the arbor where I had been given my Indian name, and we did her honor. We prepared a sumptuous feast for her and for other members of her family and mine. And it was an occasion in the Kiowa way. That is how you do honor to someone. You feed them. You overfeed them. Old Kyle custom. Well, she came over. She came. My father and I went and got her and brought her to the arbor. She was very small and frail. She was dressed in the traditional way of a Kyle matron. She was wearing a full-sleeved, long dress with an apron-like sash. Her hair was thin and gray and drawn back and put under a net. Her face was lined with age. She had only one eye. I don't know how she lost the other. And she seemed very weak, and I thought, oh boy, you know, I'm going to do her in pretty quickly. She's not up to a long interview, certainly. And she sat on one of the benches in the arbor, huddled over above herself, you know, and it didn't seem possible that so many years, 100 years, a century, could be so compacted and distilled. And she closed her one eye, you know, and leaned her head over and appeared to be asleep. But you'd say something and she would perk up, you know. So I couldn't speak Kiowa, not her Kiowa anyway. And she couldn't speak English. So my father interpreted and I asked her a number of questions. I knew that she had been to the last Kiowa Sundance. 1887, she was a young girl, and she attended that dance. There were very few people alive who had been to Sundance. So I was very curious, you know, wanted to see if she could remember anything about having been there. Grandmother, you were at the last Kiowa Sundance. Can you tell me? Tell me something about it. How did it begin? And when I asked the question, she, you know, sat up and she scowled. She put on this most wonderful face of disapproval, you know. And she, don't ask about that, grandson. Don't ask. Nobody about that. It's too far in the past. Nobody knows about that. And then she answered the question in minute detail. Her memory shot attack. But she scared the hell out of me. I thought, what have I done? You know, she reacted to my question in such a way. And so I dared to ask another question. Same thing. Don't ask about that. Nobody knows anything about that. But let me tell you, I answered the question. Well, it was an unforgettable experience. But I had asked her about the beginning of the Sundance, and she said, I was a young girl, and I was asleep. And my older sisters came and shook me awake. They said, get up, come on out, you must see. So, you know, I rubbed my eyes and I went out and I looked, and the cabin, oh, the cabin was beautiful. Everything had been cleaned, and there were brilliant pennants, ribbons tied to the lodge poles, and everyone was dressed in his or her best finery. It was unforgettable, she said. And my sister said, you come, you must make an offering to the Taimei. The Taimei is the Sundance fetish. It's a medicine bundle, the most powerful medicine in the tribe. It's given to the Kiowas by the crows. And she said, I felt so bad because I had nothing to give. I had no offering. But one of my sisters gave me a piece of trade cloth, red cloth. It was pretty. And she told me to put it on the Taimei tree. And so I did. I went and I put the offering on the tree where the Taimei bundles hung. It was exposed. It was the only time during the year, the Sundance, when the Taimei fetish could be taken from its bundle and was exposed. So she put the offering on the tree above the Taimei fetish. She said, I felt very happy. It made me feel so happy to be able to make an offering. And then she said, I saw them bring the head of the buffalo bull. Buffalo was the sacrificial victim of the Sundance, and the buffalo bull had to be killed, and its head was impaled in the Sundance lodge. And she saw them bring the head in. And then she said, oh, yes, and there was an old woman She was coming down from the hills, and she was carrying, she had something on her back, this old woman. And the boys and girls of the Rabbit Society, they went out to see what it was on her back. We were all watching. The old woman had a bag full of earth on her back. It was a certain kind of sandy earth. That is what you must have in the lodge. The dancers must dance upon the sandy earth. Then the woman came into the camp, and she had a digging tool in her hand, and she turned towards the south and pointed with her lips. It was like a kiss, and she began to sing. "Now we have brought the earth," she sang. "Now it is time to play. As old as I am, I still have the feeling of play." That, Kosan said, is how the Sundance began. It is how it always began. Well, you know, that afternoon talking to Kosan is, I write about that in the epilogue to The Waiter Rainy Mountain. I know that some of you have read that book in class, and so you know about that epilogue. She was a wonderful old woman, and I spent a wonderful afternoon with her. That is the only time I ever saw her. But it was a great day in my life. And she was so generous of spirit, and she told me all these wonderful things. Where words touch the earth, there is the sacred. And the sacred is essentially a moral agent of healing. In the world of native peoples, this equation is at the very center of life. I have a friend who knows this equation. His name is Jeremiah Ipen, and he is a poet, a reindeer herder, and a Hunti man. One day I visited him in his camp north of Hanti-Mansisk, just east of the Urals, and just north of the Yamal, just south of the Yamal Peninsula in Siberia. He told me of the Hunti Bear Feast. This is what he said. The hunter brings the bear to the edge of the village in a sledge, and the people go out to welcome their wild guest. He is taken to his own shum, or house. His overcoat is removed gently, and bright coins are placed at his eyes. One by one, the people kiss his face and bid him good evening. And then the first singer, who knows 100 songs, approaches, and the hunter asks, "Where are you going?" And the singer replies, "I'm going to the bear's house." And the hunter says, "Why, that is where I am going." And the singer begins to sing. Being a bear, I appreciate bear ceremony, and that one I have not seen, the Hunti Bear Feast, but I want to see it. I told things about it, and it must be a wonderful, wonderful ceremony. If it's a male bear that is killed, the ceremony goes on for 5 days. If it's a female bear, the ceremony goes on for, did I say 4 days? 4 days for the male, 5 if it's a female bear. The interesting thing about that ceremony to me is that the bear is paid great respect. He's placed in his own house, and he becomes the host of the ceremony, also its sacrificial victim. So, you know, it serves these two functions, and they are sacred indeed. John McPhee, who's writing, some of you know, I spent last year, I was in Alaska for the fall terms, a year ago. I was at the University of Fairbanks, and I went there to to teach for the semester because I wanted to learn something about Native Alaskan culture. And I got to visit a good many Native villages, and I went to potlatches and saw dances of a kind that I had never seen, and I ate foods that I had never eaten before. I went up to the Arctic Village, which is in the far northeast section of the state, and it's on the border of the Alaskan Wildlife Preserve, where they're thinking of drilling for oil. It is probably my last real wilderness in North America. And they are subsistence people. The cuisine Athabascan people. There are about 300 people in the village, and they live on the caribou, the Porcupine River caribou herd that comes through there twice a year. 80% of their diet is caribou. And it is remote. You can only get in there by plane. And it had been the first snowfall when I went there. And it was just absolutely pristine, beautiful. But in preparation for my visit to Alaska, I read John McPhee's book called Coming into the Country. And he talks about grizzlies, among other things. And he makes a wonderful point. He says that when you come into grizzly country, you must understand that you are the grizzly's guest. He has dominion in that world, and you had better be aware of it. Better be aware of it. Grizzlies are wonderful animals, as you they're superior to humans. And I mean that literally. You know, there was a time, I'm very much interested in primate art, and I have been to some of the great prehistoric caves in the south of France and the north of Spain. And these animals on the walls are wonderful. And you understand when you look at them that the artist thought of them as deities, that he revered them, that he, you know, he thought of them, he thought of the animals as being emissaries from the other world. They had great importance in his life. And we have lost that kind of respect for wildlife, for wilderness. But I tell you, if you are in the grizzly country for a time, and you see these huge animals, and you understand that they can outrun racehorses over a short course. Their strength is incredible. Their sense of smell is, you know, uncanny. You understand that you are their guest. You are there at their behest and not otherwise. If you fail to keep that in mind, you can get into very serious trouble. And the other day I heard about a man who was in that country, he found himself face to face with a grizzly bear, and he turned and ran as fast as he could. The bear was coming after him and gaining on him, of course. And the man came up against a cliff, a wall, rock. And he turned around and he dropped to his knees and he put his hands together. And he said, "Dear Lord, give this bear religion." The bear came up to the man, came to a sliding stop, dropped to its knees, raised its paws, and said, "Dear Lord, thank you for this food that I am about to eat." I want to read you something from a book called In the Bear's House, and I know that some of you have seen that too in some of your classes. But inasmuch as I want to talk about story, and of course, now that the bear has entered into my remarks, I want to read you a bear-dog dialogue. There are several of these in this book, and they are conversations, they are dialogues between God and the bear. And God is called Yahweh, which is an ancient name for God. It's not the oldest name, but it is very old. And the bear's name is Urset, which is a kind of play upon words, Ur being bear in French, say. Sate is a kind of word for bear. And Ur bear, Urset is, you know, original, Ur language, the original. This is the original bear. And in this dialogue, they talk about story. It is morning in the meadow, and Yahweh sits at a small table, braced upon his arms, a mug of coffee in hand. And Urset stands behind him, picking fleas from Yahweh's hair. They make barbershop talk. I'm going to play both parts, of course. And Yahweh speaks first. Yahweh. I created fleas with my thumbs, surely, and I must have got up on the wrong side of the bed that day. Urset says, to tell you the truth, great mystery, some of us, the furry and the hairy among us especially, have wondered about that. Dog actually speaks ill of you behind your back. And I am told that he speaks of my hirsute bear suit. Yahweh, he gossips in proportion as he scratches. He tells stories. Verse 6. Yes, he tells stories. Our great mystery, what is it to tell a story? Yahweh, what? What is it to tell, verse 7, a story? Yahweh, well, it is a telling. It is to tell of what has happened. It is a narration of events. Verse 7, yesterday I walked upon the mountain. Is that a story? Yahweh, no. A story must have a shape, a design, and it must have some consequential meaning. Yesterday, Urset walked upon the mountain. So what? It's a declarative sentence, not a story. What happened to you as you walked upon the mountain? Urset, I think I see what you're getting at. Here, yesterday I walked upon the mountain. There I met a man who was desperately hungry. I had some food, I gave it to him. He was most thankful. Yahweh, yes, Urset, you've told a story. Excellent. Urset, well, there isn't much to it, after all. Yahweh, more than you know, perhaps. The story you've told is a slight affair, that's true. It lacks those elements that are the essentials, the essences of story. Wonder, delight, belief, and grace. It isn't very interesting, if I may say so, but there is more to tell, I think. Urset, I suppose it is barely a story. Yahweh, there are stories, and there are stories. Urset, they are innumerable, I suppose. Yahweh, well, there is only one story after all, but there are many stories in the one. Urset, the one story, it must be very old. Yahweh, it is older than I, for I am contained in it. It has neither beginning nor end in time. Urset, the hunter, walked upon the mountain. There he met a man who was starving and was too weak to travel on. Urset gave the man food, and the man was revived. He was entirely thankful, and he invited Urset to his home. The man's wife made a dish of fish parts in broth, and they feasted. The man's children sang and danced for Urset's amusement, and her Seth the Hunter was justly famous and widely acclaimed in the land. The end. Yari, bravo! Bravo! You astonish me, Urset. Urset the Hunter met a man. Yari, wonderful! Urset, they feasted and the children sang and danced. Yari, delightful! Urset the Hunter was famous and widely acclaimed in the land. Yahweh, it calls for a willing suspension of misbelief. Urset, your turn, great mystery, tell us a story. Yahweh, Urset the Hunter walked upon the mountain. There he met a man who was desperately hungry. Urset gave the man food, but it was too little and too late, and the man perished. Urset the Hunter grieved and was ashamed. He strove then to become a better hunter, indeed the best of all. From that time on, he brought food to the man's widow and orphans, enough to sustain them. And the widow flourished, and the children grew up in wonder, delight, belief, and grace. And Urset the Hunter was justly famous and widely acclaimed in the land. Urset. Oh, it is a story well told, great mystery. That it were true, Yahweh, that it were not, all the stories are true. Urset, yes, it may be so, but do you know, great mystery, there is yet one thing about the story I do not understand. Oh, I think I know what wonder and delight and belief are and how they inform the story. All that is clear enough. But grace, I do not know what is meant by grace. Where in the story is a place for grace? Yahweh, that is the most important element of all. A story in which there is not the realization of grace is but a shadow, a shell, a thing without substance. Grace is the substance of story, albeit invisible and remote. Grace is the soul of story. Urset, it is a presence without its mask, Yahweh, or perhaps a mask behind which there is no presence. Urset, there is nothing. Yahweh, a mask of words behind which there is nothing, only silence, a perfect stillness. Urset, grace. Curtain falls at that moment. Thank you very much for listening.
Stand where you are. There are also microphones here that we can move to the aisle.